Yes. So happy morning to one and all present here. This is Dr. S. Palaniappan, Associate Professor, Department of CSE, KCG College of Technology. I welcome the speaker of the session, Dr. S. Venkatesan, and all the participants on behalf of the management, director, principal, HOD, CSE, coordinator, and the team of AACT Athal sponsored online FDP on blockchain. Most of you might have heard about Dr. S. Venkatesan in the last session, and those who have missed his session, just small introduction about him. Dr. S. Venkatesan, working at IIIT as an associate professor, Department of Information Technology, and is having 14 years of research and teaching in various domains and technologies. His area of research includes blockchain, mobile agent security, cryptography, cloud computing, and social network privacy. And he is a reviewer in various journals, including IEEE Transactions on System, Man, and Cybernetics, International Journal of Network and Applications, Elsevier, International Journal of Applied Mathematics and Computation, Elsevier, International Journal of Netnomics, Economic Research, and Electronic Networking, Springer. And he has published 8 international journals, attended 12 conferences, and written 2 book chapters. And he is also into software development and received funds for 3 projects. So we welcome once again Dr. S. Venkatesan. So over to Dr. S. Venkatesan, sir.
So thank you, Dr. Palaniappan. It's good introduction.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, good morning to everyone.
Sir, so I'll just stop my sharing, sir. You can share your screen.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You can share your screen, sir.
Okay. I will do that. So, good morning to all. Yesterday, we were discussing about this fabric. In case you have doubt, please let me know. So, meantime, I will open share the slides. I hope this one is visible.
Yes, sir.
It is visible, okay. Sir.
So I will get into IOTA a little later, but before that, I would like to explain something, because this, whatever as a question I am going to put, that has to be answered when it comes to IOTA, because IOTA never gives the transaction fee. So do you have any doubts on the last session, what I took? Okay, I assume that there are no doubts. So out of these 3 structure, you very well know that blockchain users or the blockchain network works according to this particular structure of the network. So even though we say it is decentralized, but you can see in the decentralized, there will be one connectivity from one set to another set, which will be always problematic. The reason is, if this particular link is down or this particular node behave maliciously, then we will be into a lot of trouble. That means this particular subset will be made as the isolated subset. So that is the reason they form such kind of network, which is distributed. But you see that it is not completely distributed. The reason is there are numerous number of machines, and each machine cannot connect with each other like the mesh network. So, but here they form the distributed network, since each node is connected with more than one neighbor. But as per the implementation of Ethereum, what it says is at least you should have 7 neighbors, because if one neighbor fails or 2 neighbors fail, then the other neighbors will help you to take part in the network. But there is a problem of Eclipse attack that I will come to it, how that can be solved. So now you see, this is the actual structure you can see in the blockchain network. Maybe that this has more than 2 connections. Let's say the important question comes here. We know that when we do mining, there will be a mining reward which will be given to the miner. And the miner will also get the transaction fee. So now let's say this particular node, we assume that this is Alice. Alice would like to make a transaction, and once it constructs the transaction, it pass on to these two nodes, because these are the only two nodes available as neighbor to her, and this has to further broadcast to the next level of nodes, and slowly this will get into the complete network. So now the important question is, please try to understand, when Alice sends the transaction here and here, why these two nodes have to forward further? Because Alice makes the transaction, and that is only for her, it is beneficial for her, and it will be beneficial for the destination, that may be Bob. So in between, there are nodes who are not going to get any benefit from the transaction. Then why these particular nodes, these two nodes, have to forward the transaction further? So do you have any idea why it has to be forwarded? Hello. Anyone have answer for this? Because everybody looks for the profit. So when there is no profit, why should someone forward the transaction of others? And what encourages in Bitcoin or Ethereum or in blockchain network to forward further? Okay, so why these particular nodes need to forward is, these nodes may be the miner nodes, mining nodes. So when they have to do the mining, they have to consider some set of transactions. So those transactions set may include Alice transaction also. When this particular node takes the transaction of Alice and mine the block and forward to the neighbors, and let's assume that neighbors are not having the transaction, then what will happen? These nodes cannot validate the block. So if these nodes are not validating the blocks, it will not further forward the block. If it does not further forward the block, then what will happen? Whatever mining effort put by this node will go useless. So that is the reason the neighbor nodes will definitely forward the transaction, even though they are not going to get any benefit with respect to reward. So I hope it is clear to all. And the second question is, why, let's assume now Alice mines the block and give it to the neighbor. When Alice mines the block and give it to neighbor, why this neighbor have to forward the block? So because the Alice mines the block, so Alice is going to get the reward, and the neighbors are not going to get the reward, then why should they forward the block? So the reason is, let's say Alice mined the block number 5, and that is broadcasted to her neighbor, and the neighbor have to work on the 6th block, because they know already that the 5th block is mined by Alice, so they have to work on the 6th block. So when they work on the 6th block, the base block for that 6th block will be the 5th block of Alice. So when these node, maybe this or this node, have to make that particular 6th block to be the part of main chain, this has to make the 5th block to be part of the main chain. So it makes, or it mandates these nodes, these mining nodes, to forward the block further, so that they will get their block to be part of the main chain. So these are the two reasons why the transactions are forwarded, and why the blocks are forwarded by the neighboring nodes, even though there is no reward or we can say transaction fee given to the neighbors. So I hope it is clear. So why I put this question is, in case of IOTA, there is no reward or any transaction fee given to the miners. There is no miner, the transaction approvers are there. So why should they approve the transaction? So such kind of question comes. So that time, this will be somewhat clear. This will give you a clear picture when we discuss that. And one more attack I would like to discuss here itself. Let's say this node is connected only with these two nodes. Okay, there are no other neighbors. And we assume that these two nodes are colluded with each other. When these two nodes are colluded, what will happen if this particular, and they have colluded and also they are the attacker against Alice. When Alice forward the transaction or the block, they will not further forward it. So what happens is there is an eclipse formed here. Okay, on the top of Alice, an eclipse is formed. The eclipse is these colluded attackers. So whatever Alice sends, that will not be forwarded further. And whatever these neighbors receives, they won't give it to Alice. So what happens in that case, even though Alice is connected to the network, but she is isolated from the actual network. So how this problem can be solved in Ethereum, they always say that make sure at least one of the neighbors will be the developer node. So when you connect with the developer node, then what happens, even though the other node forms the eclipse, the developer will not form the eclipse. The reason is, if the developer also misbehaves, then the network will go as untrusted one, as well as the share in the share market, their value will go down. Once the value will go down, the money equivalency of Ether will come down. Okay, so that's why the developer never performs any type of malicious activity. So I hope this one is clear to you all. If any questions you have, please let me know. So I will move on to IOTA slide now. So meantime, if any of you having questions, please ask me. So is this visible? Hello?
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay. So IOTA is called as the tangle. The reason why they call it as the tangle is there will be a graph formed. The graph is the directed acyclic graph, and the transactions are the nodes in the graph. And the tangle will be keep on growing, because we know that whenever the growth of the block or the growth of the transaction stops, then we may announce that, or we can announce that the particular application is failed or the particular application is dead. So similarly, here also the transactions should be keep on growing. In case it stops, so the application is dead. So as I said in the last session itself, I took various figures and contents from so many sources. So I'd like to thank all the authors for that. So before getting into IOTA, I would like to discuss few things about IoT. So we know very well that IoT is the interconnected things which are embedded with sensors. This is the definition given in the Wikipedia, and it was coined by Kevin Ashton in 1999. And the important question to be answered here is, we know World Wide Web, that is WWW we have, and ubiquitous computing we have, because in World Wide Web we say that it is centralized, but in case of ubiquitous computing we say it is distributed and it is placed at multiple places. So now what makes IoT different from these two terms? See, we cannot define this because it is the network of interconnected things. We should not give this as the definition. The reason is this is the definition for the networks. So the IoT is one of the applications on the network, and this World Wide Web and ubiquitous computing is also one of the applications on the top of the network. So then what makes IoT different from these two things? So anybody having any idea what is the difference between IoT and World Wide Web or ubiquitous computing? See, don't think that in the morning itself I put lot of questions to you. Okay, this is only to make
sir,
the interaction.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, IoT to function, it needs internet.
Okay.
And based on the internet protocols only, the Internet of Things will work.
Okay.
Whereas ubiquitous computing, we may think independent of working without the internet.
So you mean to say in ubiquitous computing, small I internet is sufficient, but when we go for IoT, we need capital I internet, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Exactly,
oh,
sir.
Okay. Then anything else, please?
I think in ubiquitous computing, we use the homogeneous network.
Okay.
Probably the connectivity should be like anywhere, anytime we should be connected to the network, we could be able to access the service.
Okay.
But the devices should be homogeneous. So, but okay. Unlike in case of Internet of Things, so the devices may be heterogeneous and the network may be also heterogeneous.
Okay, okay. So anything else? So the important difference is, or the major difference, I can say, IoT never needs the human involvement. Okay, that is the major difference between IoT and other things. But people say something else also, but I don't accept, because this is the only thing. But don't assume that in IoT, never the human interaction is required. There may be the requirement, depend on the application we develop, but IoT has the facility where you don't need any human involvement. It does the operation automatically on its own, but you have to bring the intelligence into it. So when we use the IoT, let's take the home automation or the industrial automation. So most of the time we keep the centralized server-based communication, that is the IoT devices, whatever it senses, it give it to the server and it get the response. So when it is centralized, we all know there are many drawbacks. The important thing is single node failure. If the node fails, that is the server fails, then complete application will be dead. And also when the number of devices increase, then the number of interactions with the server will increase. And the interaction increases, there will be definitely delay in giving the service. So these are the problems when we go for the centralization. And the solution we know is the decentralization. So to ensure the decentralization, we can use the blockchain. But what will be the advantage of using the blockchain decentralization is, there is no problem of central failure. That is, single point of failure is not going to create any issue. And the data will be stored in multiple places or the across the devices. So why this decentralization will help the IoT network to perform better? Let's say we have this smart city, and in the smart city, we have the smart transportation. Okay, and we assume that in the smart transportation, there are vehicles moving on, and in some places there is a traffic, heavy traffic. So let's assume that in case of places, that's the nodes, whatever is having this OBU, it has to contact the centralized server and get the details. So there will be definitely delay. Instead of that, it interacts with the neighbors, then it will get the feedback immediately and act on it, so that the processing will be faster, as well as the decision making will be faster. So that's why when we are decentralizing it, the complete environment will be smooth when compared to the centralized environment. However, there are security issues comes that we have to solve. That's the different case. So whenever we talk about decentralization, the best solution come to our mind is the blockchain. This we have already discussed. I don't get into it. And blockchain properties also, you know very well. And you remember I was telling some difference between the conventional distributed database and the blockchain. What's the difference? These are also some of the differences you can go through. And this is reported in the IOTA paper because they say that if we don't have blockchain, then who would run this database? In which country would it be hosted? These are some of the questions to be answered when we are going for the conventional database. So if somebody asks why we need blockchain, so these questions can be useful for justifying that. So in any network, we know there are two types of nodes, light node and full node. This you might have gone through already, but I put one more node, which is the client node, who is not taking part in or actively participating in the blockchain network. So those are the one who have the account, but never stores the blockchain or never participate in mine. So again, so you can see the comparison between the Bitcoin and Ethereum. I hope you have some idea or you have gone through the detail of Bitcoin and Ethereum. So Bitcoin and Ethereum both are cryptocurrency, and Ethereum supports decentralized application, but Bitcoin does not support. And how it works? Bitcoin works based on transaction, that is UTXO and spent transaction output. Ethereum works based on the balance. The consensus in both of the implementations are the proof of work, and both are probabilistic because there is a fork possible in the chain. And confirmation time, this is the time based on the block mining, that is 10 minutes average in Bitcoin and 15 seconds average in Ethereum. And in both, fork is possible. And waiting time, so this waiting time is required when we want to solve the two generals problem. So 7 blocks we have to wait, because let's assume that my transaction is part of your block and the block is accepted. So I should not act on the transaction immediately, because that particular block may be go as the fork in the later case. Okay, so we have to wait for the next 7 blocks so that we will be confirmed that the particular transaction containing block will be part of the main chain. These numbers, these 7 and 23, are not through any mathematical proof. Based on the practical experience, they have given this. And both are centralized, a decentralized one, and there is no authority. But when we talk about proof of authority in Ethereum, there is an authority. That is the permission network. And both are permissionless. And world state, Bitcoin does not have, that Ethereum has. Here, the world state is the snapshot what we are discussing yesterday. So this is the difference between the Bitcoin and Ethereum. There are some other differences, but I took the major one. Now, what is the need of IOTA? Why not we go with Ethereum or Bitcoin? So the first thing comes is, yesterday itself I was talking about the puzzle solving, that how much time it took for me to generate the output, hash output, within the threshold. So when the threshold is put as very less, then what will happen? There is a need of lot of computation. When the computation increases, because the computation needs too much computing power, and all those computing power devices need the electricity. So if you see the consumption of electricity, that for the Bitcoin, you can see how much it is consuming. So even sometimes they say that it consumes one state of US, whatever power is consumed in that particular state, the equivalent is spent for the mining in Bitcoin. So similarly for Ethereum, this also takes too much energy. So now this I have already shown you. Okay, so now the question is, if this much electricity is required and this much computational power is required, then will our IoT device sustain? So because in our IoT devices or in our IoT network, we will be having small devices or the constrained devices, which will be having 1 GB RAM, sometimes 256 MB RAM, or we can say the processing capacity of 1.2 GHz and with one core. So how this can be tolerated? Even for this, this is of one normal computer that itself takes this much time, then you think about the IoT devices. Can we apply the IoT environment, or can we use blockchain into the IoT environment? So that is not at all feasible. Even we are trying with Raspberry Pi, we use the Ethereum. Okay, and I have not put the result here. It takes a lot of time, even though it never takes part in mining, but to access the record itself, it takes at least 24 milliseconds. Okay, sometimes this will be very high when it comes into the network where we want to achieve the faster communication or faster processing. So in those cases, we cannot go for Ethereum-based application. So in that case, we can prefer the IOTA for the implementation. So that is, if we use IOTA, we can justify that the too much computational power is not required and the constrained devices can be adapted into the network. So this is IOTA is also cryptocurrency, and it was first conceptualized in 2014, later founded in 2015. And this guy, Sergey Popov, is the main guy who take part in this IOTA development. And you can see this. This is a cryptocurrency for the Internet of Things industry. Okay. So this is also in live. That IOTA is in live. IOTA cryptocurrency is in live. And we are using, we simulated in our lab by downloading the code from the GitHub. And we have made some testing using the IOTA tool without any cryptocurrency for our application. This is the directed acyclic graph, as I said. So in that format, only transactions are stored. And this supports micropayments. Let's say in Bitcoin, I want to make the transaction, which is 0.02 Bitcoin. And let's assume that the transaction fee is 0.03. So in that case, is there any point in doing such transaction? So we are going to be in loss. So to overcome those things, the IOTA provides the micropayments, because in IOTA, there is no transaction fee or no reward. People have to otherwise, they cannot continue in the network. That I will let you know in the future slides why they have to contribute. And another difference is, in case of Bitcoin and Ethereum, the coins grow gradually. Okay, if you see in Bitcoin, they put 21 million BTC is the highest. After that, no further increase in the coin. That is as of now. Maybe they can increase it later. And in case of Ethereum, there is no restriction. It keeps on growing. But in IOTA, at the initial stage, they have put this much is possible in the IOTA network. You cannot go more than this. And we have to, the transaction has to happen within this money only. So let's say in our RBI, they print the currency and they never print further. Let's assume like that. So in that case, whatever the currency is already available, the same thing will be in circulation. So like that, they have also done. This is the maximum currency, and this was put in the Genesis block. And only this money will be transferring between the or among the users of the IOTA network. And it was released in the first version was released in the 13th June 2017. So the important notations to be, let me show you. So the tangle will be like this. You can see the Genesis block, and then there are transactions. Here there is no concept of block. Here they call it as bundle. And the bundle will be containing set of transactions. So this is one bundle, another bundle, and it will be keep on going like this. This side it will be moving. So you can see more detail. So you can see here. Okay, it will be moving like this. So everything is a transaction bundle. Be an initial genesis. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you, sir. Continue, sir.
Okay, okay. Are the slides visible?
Yes, sir. It is visible, sir.
Okay, okay. So this is the Genesis file, that is the Genesis transaction bundle, and this is the these are the transactions put by some of the participants, and you see these transactions must approve this transaction, or this transaction must approve these two transactions, then only this transaction will be part of the network. So I will come to it. And there are some important notations. See, any of you not able to follow up because I am skipping the slides here and there. If you face any trouble, please let me know. Accordingly, I will try to change the flow. So it has different notations and this should be understood. So the first thing, let's take tip. I will go to this later. Tip is the transaction that are not yet approved by any other transaction. So what happens is when I make a transaction to the IOTA, I create my transaction. After creating the transaction, I have to find out the existing transaction in the IOTA network, that is the IOTA tangle, and I will see which transactions are not yet approved. I will choose any of those transactions and I approve those transactions. So what approval here means, I will see whether the signature done by the owner is proper or not, and the balance of the owner is available or not, and the receiver account is available or not. So these things are considered as the approval. If everything is fine, then what I will do is in my transaction, I will give the link. That is the hash of those whatever approved transactions will be present on my transaction bundle. In that way, it is considered as my transaction is approved the existing two transaction or N transaction. So here what tip means, a transaction which is not yet approved by any other transaction, okay, which is the new transaction come into the network and it is not yet approved by any of the transactions. And wait, what is the wait is, for every transaction there is a wait given. In the paper or in the theory, they say that different wait for different transactions. But in the implementation, whatever is available there, they have given equal weightage for all the transactions. The wait is one. And next is the cumulative wait and then the score. So what happens in one case, I approve a transaction and that transaction approved some previous transaction and the previous transaction. So those weights are coming under as the cumulative weight, and there are those are called as the score, and there are transactions which approved my transactions. So those will be called as the cumulative weight. So let me tell you in more detail. So you can go through this. So cumulative weight, it is the weight of a particular transaction plus sum of weights of all transactions that directly or indirectly approve this transaction. So you can see in this. See, you can see the cumulative transaction, cumulative weight. So the weight is 4. Why the weight is 4 is its own weight, that is 1. And this is approved by another transaction and that weight is 3. So the total is 4. So then this one becomes the cumulative weight. Similarly, if you see this one, its own weight 1. And the cumulative weight of the all the things 3, 1, 3 and 1. So if you see the total, it comes to be 8 and here its own weight is 1. So the cumulative weight is 9. So similarly, score is computed. The score is whatever is approved by this particular node. Let's take the transaction C. So this approves these two transactions and these two transactions approved these transactions. So the total becomes 7. So why this score or cumulative weight required? This will be used to identify whether the particular transaction is as accepted by majority of the users in the network or not. If it is accepted by majority of users, then the particular transaction will be considered as the confirmed transaction. Otherwise, it will be considered as the pending transaction. So these are the important notations to be known in IOTA. And I was telling that if I put any transaction, my transaction should approve some of the existing transaction. So they say it has to approve K number of transaction, but in the real time implementation, it is given as K as 2. Whenever a person put his or her transaction, and that transaction has to approve another two transactions, that is the tips available in the network. And why I have to approve the other transaction? If I approve other transaction, then only my transactions will be approved. That's the reason the transaction has to be my transaction has to approve the other transaction. So can anyone tell, here is the tip. So in this tangle, which transaction is called as the tip? So if so, then which transaction in this or transactions in this are called as the tip transaction? See, I hope.
Sir, the participants are answering in the chat window. Jay Sharma have answered F.
But they can speak it out. I cannot see the window, madam.
So it will be available in the top, sir. You can see the top participants.
No, actually, I am on the slides, right?
Okay,
sir. It's on the full screen. Because this will make me to understand whether the
participants. If there is any message in the chat box, we will read out for you, sir.
Okay. So here the tips are A and then C. B cannot be the tip because B is already approved by A. So A and C are the tip. So when I have to put a transaction, I have to traverse, because up to this I will be having in my network. I have to traverse from somewhere. I have to choose this node or this node. I have to traverse in this way and I have to find out what transactions are the tip. And I have to choose those transactions, then I have to approve it. Okay, how the traversal will happen, that I will explain you in the future slides. So the question, you remember whatever I put in the beginning. So the same question repeats here, and here we know that there are no rewards. Why should Alice approve others' transaction? Okay, the second question is because there is no reward. The second question is, why should Alice propagate others' transactions to neighbors? Okay, so the answer to the question is, the first question, if I approve others' transaction, then only my transaction will get approved. So this encourages the participants to approve others' transaction. Second, why should someone propagate others' transaction? So here what happens, if you are actively take part in the network, your neighbors will have your identity on their neighbors list. If you don't take active participation, want to make a transaction, you need to find out the tip. To find out the tip, you need the complete tangle, and the tangle is not with you because neighbors are not sharing the tangles with you because you are not in the list. So in that case, you have to wait for long to get the complete tangle. After that, you have to identify the tip and approve the transaction. So this encourages the participants to propagate the transactions of others to the neighbor. So here in the previous I was telling in the beginning that there are two types of nodes. One is the full node and light node. But here they have four types of nodes. First, let's go to the full node, what the full node does. So we know in the Bitcoin or Ethereum, full node is the one which takes part in mining and it stores block header as well as data part. But here what happens, it stores the subtangle or snapshot plus all subsequent transactions of the tangle. So what this means is, it will store the complete tangle. At one point of time, it is not having the sufficient storage. So what it does is it takes the snapshot. That means whatever the latest data of every user, that let's assume the balance. So all those balance will be put as a snapshot in their database. Then the tangle, whatever was the previous subtangle, that will be completely deleted from its storage. The new or the growing subtangle, the further growing subtangle will be put in its storage. So let me come to this. So let's say the tangles are growing like this, and I have a IoT device which have the sufficient storage to store up to this. When the tangle grows like have the the device does not have the storage to store all these things. So what the device can do, it can take the snapshot of this. Snapshot in the sense, the account balance of each and every user will be stored in the table, and these all will be deleted. So once these all will be deleted, there will be sufficient space to store the remaining. So then further will go on like this. At one point of time, again, the snapshot will be taken. Then further it will go like this. So this is what the full node does. So you can understand the difference in case of Bitcoin and Ethereum full node. We assume that it has the sufficient infrastructure. It stores the complete blockchain, and also it takes part in mining. But here the thing is different. And light node is the node which never stores anything. Okay, you remember that I was talking about the client node in Bitcoin and Ethereum. Here that node is called as the light node. And the third type of node is the permanent node, which stores the complete tangle. It never takes the snapshot. It will be keep on storing whatever is coming in the tangle. And next is the coordinator node. So permanent node and coordinator node, we can say both are same because both will store the complete tangle. The difference between the permanent node and coordinator node, the coordinator nodes are the developer nodes, the who has created the IOTA network. Okay, they are also part of the network. Why they take part in the network is they have to continuously monitor the network. Is there any malicious activity is going on? So that's why they put some transaction in between and approve the existing transaction. The transaction by the coordinator node is called as the milestone transaction. If any of the existing transaction approved by the milestone transaction, then we no need to wait for the majority of users to approve it. Because once the developer approved a transaction, that means the transaction is confirmed. Okay, so please remember the milestone transaction that has to be used when we are going to identify the tip. So we have so many type of nodes, and all nodes should have the address. If we talk about Ethereum, how the address computed for each and every node is, they take the public key there. They use the elliptic curve cryptography system. So the public key of the elliptic curve will be taken, and that will be hashed using the SHA-3 hashing algorithm. And in the output, they take the last 20 bytes or we can say the 20 characters. And that is used as the address for a node. So here how the address is computed. So they generate some random seed. Okay, so that random seed can be generated using DES algorithm, or it can be generated through the timing and the number of process going on, or it can be using any hashing method also. So some seed will be generated, and the seed will be concatenated with an index. Okay, the index will be 1, 2, 3, 4. So why they are doing like that is, IOTA never encourages to reuse the address. So once I use the address, and that is only for one time, next time I should not use the same address. Okay, the reason I will let you know. So they never encourage to reuse the address. So how can we generate n number of address? So what we can do is we will be having the random seed, and then we will be having the index. Index will be 1, and give it to the hash function. It will produce an output, and that output will be the first address. And for the second address, the same random seed, and the index will be 2, then the output, then 3, 4. Okay, it will be keep on going like that. So in that way, we can generate n number of addresses. So why they say don't use the address, reuse the address? The first thing, if you are reusing the address, then anonymity will go off. So let's assume that Alice sends some money to Bob. Okay, now Bob knows the address of Alice, and also he can Alice's personal identity. So in that case, he knows that Bob knows that this address belongs to Alice. If Alice use the same address for all the communication and the network is public, Bob will know all the activity of the Alice. So that's why the anonymity will not be there and privacy will be off. So this makes the IOTA to encourage the users to don't reuse the address. And next thing is compromise of account. Once attacker compromise one of the addresses, then what happened? They can completely compromise the particular user account. And the third thing, it uses a kind of algorithm, hashing algorithm. When it is used for the digital signature, for every digital signature, the algorithm discloses a part of the key. So if you are using the same address and you use multiple transactions with signature, and every signature is going to disclose part of the key. So finally, what will happen? The complete key will be disclosed. So this is the problem of IOTA digital signature implementation. So because of these three reasons, the IOTA always says to the participants, never reuse the address. Otherwise, you will be getting into these problems. And you can see that random seed I was telling that it can be generated through the AES or DES algorithm or as well as the linear feedback shift register also. But there should be a seed for the algorithm. The seed will be user secret password, and that will be given to the function to generate it. So you can see this is the bundle, transaction bundle. So that box what we have seen in the Tangle, you can see there are two transactions, that is the tip one and tip two. So these are the two transactions. This particular transaction of mine is approving. And you can see in one transaction, there are n number of transactions. Why this n number of transactions required in a single transaction? Because when you make a transaction, you need sender address, destination address, and the amount you are going to spend. But the same, this is with respect to Ethereum. The same is not possible in Bitcoin, because you have to generate some input transaction and you have to generate some output transaction. So in that case, you need multiple transactions inside a single transaction. So similarly, inside the bundle, there are n number of transactions required to represent the input transaction and output transaction. And IOTA has another one feature that I was talking about, the address. So the address will be computed in three levels. Okay, the levels here represents the first level means the address is of some X size. And the level two means the size of the address is X plus Y. And the level three, it has the size of the address in level three is X plus Y plus Z. So why they go for these three types of addresses? They want to make sure this particular IOTA network should not be vulnerable to the quantum computers. So it is not going to come very quickly, but we know that already people started working and there are many algorithms developed to protect against the quantum computers. So they have considered the similar situation and they made their network. So they claim that even the quantum computer comes, the IOTA is safe. So when the address size is growing a lot, then in the single transaction, the complete address cannot be put. So they will segregate the transaction into different transaction and they will put the address part into one transaction. So when we have to divide the address into multiple chunks and put in a different transaction, so in all the transaction, you cannot make a money transfer. So there is there are transactions called as the zero transaction. There is no money transfer, but to whatever was missed or whatever was not added in the actual money transfer transaction, because of the space shortage, it will be put in the zero transaction. That's why there are so many transactions present in the bundle. And you can see that there are two tips that has to be approved so that this transaction will be approved by the further transactions. So very important thing. So now you can see here the tips in the in this tangle are 6, 8, 5 and 7. These are the tips. See, don't go to the topic, okay, which is not required now. So in this case, now the user who want to put the new transaction, let's say I want to put the transaction number 9. So when I have to put the transaction number 9, what I have to do is I have to approve any of the two tips, whatever is available here. To find out the tips, I have to traverse from here. So where I will start? So let's say that I am going to start from here and I will traverse and find out the two tips. So why not I start from here? Why should I start from here? So this question comes. So to address this question, the milestone transaction takes part. So let's say this transaction is the milestone transaction, which is put by the developer. So I will choose this milestone transaction as my base. And from here, I will traverse. Randomly, I will traverse on the path and I will reach to the tip. So similarly, I will go to another tip. So to choose the tip, I will find out the latest milestone transaction of a developer. And from there, I will start to traverse. And next thing, how will I traverse? Because there are so many links and I have to randomly take one path and further move. So how this is done is through Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithm. So it uses based on the weighted random walk. So I will see the weight of each and every path. You remember that we were talking about the score and the cumulative weight. So the cumulative weight will be used to choose the next path. So let's assume that this has the weight of cumulative weight of 10, 12 and 13. Okay. And based on the highest weight, and in the highest weight, there will be so many number of transactions available. So after that, I will use the randomness and then I will take that node as the next transaction as the next transaction. And from here, I will get into it. After coming to this place, again, I apply the Monte Carlo simulation. And I will choose the next node, and I will be keep on going so that finally I will reach one of the tip. So now I have to choose two tips, because you see here I choose one milestone transaction and I traverse and I get into one tip. I need more than one tip. So what I will do is I will choose n number of milestone transaction. Why I talk about n instead of two is sometimes when you are sending only two or traversing on the two path, one path may give the proper tip and another path may not give the proper tip. So what the proper here means, there are tips which are called as the lazy tip. So why we call that tip as the lazy tip? Those tips are not approved by the transaction. Let's say that the tangle is up to this and this part is here only. That means this particular tip is the lazy tip because it is not approved by any of the users. So if I am going for only two traversals, that means using two milestone, I traverse to find out the tip, I may end up with the lazy tip. If I am going to approve the lazy tip, then my tip will become the lazy tip. So that's why we have to make n random walk so that you will get two best tip in the tangle. So how the lazy tip will be identified? Because I said that this is become lazy tip when the if we visualize up to this, the tangle is growing and this is here, and we visualize, we know this as the lazy tip. But when it comes to the computer algorithms, we don't know, the algorithm does not just see it and say that this is the lazy tip. So how the algorithm will come to know that particular tip is a lazy tip or not? If the tip is reached very quickly, for example, if I start from here, And the in this level, or we can say in this subtangle, the tip is here. But in case of this subtangle, the tip is here. And assume that I start from here. So if I start from here in the fourth level itself, or the fourth layer itself, I will get the tip. And in case of these, I may get the tip after the 10th or the 12th tip, 12th level. So in that case, what happens? This becomes the quick tip identified. So that becomes the lazy tip. I hope you understand how the lazy tip will be identified. So in this way, the tip will be selected and approved by the transactions or the transaction bundle. So here also the double spending is possible, because when you go for any of the cryptocurrency network, there are double spending possible. And what that double spending is, we will be reusing the same money where we are not authorized to do it. If it comes into the physical currency, you give it to somebody, so you don't possess. But in case of digital one, you can have n number of copies and you may misuse that. So the double spending is avoided in Bitcoin and Ethereum through the proof of work concept, but people are still creating the double spending, and there are so many research going on how to stop that double spending concept, since the fork is possible. But if we go for Hyperledger kind of thing, there are no forks. Okay, so no double spending is possible. But here double spending is possible because this also has the fork. So you see that these two transactions, W and Y, these are the two transactions which are creating the double spending. The same coin is, or the same token is spent in both. And this should be approved by the other transactions. You can see that this Y is approved by 2. And this W is approved by 1. And you can see that 2 is not having any link with W, or this 1 is not having any link with Y. So what happened? They can easily perform the double spending. So that means this is also approved and this is also approved. At one point of time, this will be having sufficient cumulative weight. And here also there will be sufficient cumulative weight. So the transaction become the confirmed transaction. But what will happen? Let's assume that the further transaction comes later. And when the transaction comes, let's say the transaction is here. Okay, the transaction is going to approve the transaction, existing transaction 2. Sorry, it cannot go for 2 because 2 is not the tip transaction. It will go for 7. Okay, so now let's assume here we have the transaction as 9, and that transaction approves transaction number 7 and transaction number 8. So please do remember here, it is not that this, the we assumed transaction 9 will approve 8 and 7 and it stops it. So it never stops. It will go further also and do the check the approval, or it verifies the validity of the transaction. So when the 9 takes these two, 8 and 7, and it verifies that yes, it is perfect, then it goes to the next level, that it goes to 1 and it goes to 2, and it identifies yes, this is also proper. When it gets into Y and get into W, then it knows that there is a double spending. So when there is a double spending, what happens? This particular 9 transaction will discard this complete subtangle, or maybe this subtangle, and it will get connected with only one subtangle. So what happens? Whatever the transaction was made here in this subtangle will be considered as the double spending, and it will not be taken part in the main tangle. So it will go as the fork. And one drawback here is, along with this Y, this 2 will also go as the fork. So whatever transaction happened in this 2, that will also become void. And similarly for this 3 also. So that is the drawback when the double spending is identified in the IOTA. So similarly, there are so many other attacks possible. You know that there are selfish mining also, where people mine the blocks or make the transactions and they don't disclose immediately. At one point of time, they disclose all the things. So when they disclose all the things, there is a possibility the selfish mined blocks may overcome the existing chain, Okay, but that is very, very rare. The reason is the attackers are very less in size, even though they are colluded. The remaining we have to consider as attacker with rest of the world. Definitely, rest of the world will be having the more computational power compared to attackers. So similarly, here also it is possible, but they cannot achieve better forwarding. So better forwarding is not applicable when they are going for the selfish mining or the selfish. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay. So when they perform the selfish mining or the selfish subtangle they create, then after some time they will put into the public, and that may not give any effect because the rest of the world will be having more computational power, and the chain might have grown very fast when compared to the selfish miner's chain or the tangle, subtangle. And another problem with IOTA is, as I was telling, that lazy tip. If I have this tip and the chain, this particular subtangle is grown a lot and this one is not grown, and this is my transaction and it is not approved by majority of the users. So what I will do in that case is, to overcome my pending transaction, I have three options. One is rebroadcast, second is reattach, and third one is the promote. So in case of rebroadcast, what I do is I have broadcasted to my neighbors. Okay, and my neighbors may not forward it further. So in that case, my transaction will not become the confirmed transaction in that angle. So what I will do is I will rebroadcast the transaction so that maybe my neighbors will again take it up to forward. Okay, so this is one way to get the transaction confirmed. Second is reattaching. So I made a transaction already, and again I am going to create a new transaction for the same transaction, and I will be attaching into the network or the tangle. So let's say here, again the same W and Y I am going to consider. I have at first I put, let's assume, okay, don't consider this as the right picture, please only assume here. So I put the first transaction, which is W, and it is not confirmed yet and it is pending for a long time. So what I will do is I will create another transaction similar to this, exactly similar to this, and I have created Y as that is the copy of this, and again I attached by approving the another two transactions. So now what happens, there is a possibility this will be approved by many of the users and this become the confirmed transaction. And now you can see this transaction and this transaction, both are same, and there is a possibility the further transaction may consider this as the double spending. So how to overcome this is, in the transaction bundle, there is a attribute which is called a tag. The tag of these two transactions will be same. So when there is a transaction, there are transactions which has same tag, then people or the transactions, the further transactions will come to know these two transactions or set of transactions will be the reattachment, not the double spending transaction. So in that way, the transaction get confirmed. Next is the promote. So what we can do is we can create a zero transaction, and we ourselves will approve our existing transaction so that that one cannot become the lazy transaction, and it will also go according to the main chain, that is the proper chain growing. Okay, as I was telling here, the let's say this tank subtangle is grown up to this and this one is here. So definitely no transaction will choose this as the tip because of the laziness. So what the respective user will do, the respective user will create so many zero transactions here, because for making transaction there is no fee. So they can make n number of zero transactions, and they will try to bring with this this subtangle. Okay, they cannot bring exactly equal level, but they can bring up to some extent. So because of that, this transaction will not become the lazy transaction tangle, or we can say lazy subtangle, and this will also be chosen by the transactions, the further transactions for the approval. So in this way, the transactions can be promoted and it can get confirmed if it is pending for a long time. So this facility is provided in the IOTA. And the advantages when we go for this IOTA, the first is less computation requirement, because in Bitcoin and Ethereum, you have to invest a lot of computation, but here it is not required. But here also they use proof of work, but the target they fix is that the target is very broad target. So no need to spend a lot of computation. Okay. So it is like finding out the output, which will be less than 8 in the whole space of 10. Okay. So if you see in this, in most of the cases, we will get that output. Okay. So very quickly you can get the output. Because of that quickness, more computations are not required. So this can be applicable for any of the IoT devices to take part. And it supports the snapshot. That means if you don't have the storage, you can take the snapshot, and then further you can store, and again you can take the snapshot. So you can do like that, because you know the Raspberry Pi, if we are using, that does not have the sufficient storage. Okay, if you are going for snapshot, that can help a lot. And there is no transaction fee. This is another advantage. And the next thing, it becomes faster as it number of subscribers or transaction increases. Because when the transactions keep on increasing, the confirmation time will be faster, or the confirmation will be very quick. And this algorithm, this IOTA implementation is the quantum proof also. Okay, so even if the quantum computer comes, we can use IOTA. But that is a claim now, but we know once the quantum computer comes, whether it will survive or not. Because still a lot of time, and there will be so many cryptanalysis algorithm will be developed. Those are something not to be worried now. So now you can see the difference. See, please let me know if you have any doubt. Okay, I come to the end of IOTA. And CODA also, I will not go much. In CODA, I will be giving only the brief introduction. If any of you having doubt, please let me know.
Dear participants, if you have any doubt, you can raise your doubts. Either you can unmute yourself or you can type yourself in the chat box.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, this double spending, it can happen manually also, sir?
Manually? I don't get the question. Manually means?
Manually means, suppose if I purchase some, say, some desktop, I will give the hard cash, say, some 50,000.
Okay.
He may use the same amount for something else. The same series number of the node, the vendor may use it for some other transaction.
Yes, I understand that you are talking about the fake currency.
Yes, sir.
See, in case of physical currency, what happened, we are physically giving something to other person.
Yes.
Once we give it to other person, that same physical one cannot be reused by the person who gives. Okay, yes, let's say I am giving something to you.
Yes.
Physically, I have given to you let's assume the pen I am giving.
Yes.
Okay. I may be having n number of duplicate fake pens. That is separate. Once I give the pen to you, that the same pen, I cannot use it anywhere. Physically, I have given you.
But generally, the shop person, he will take, sometimes he gives the bill, but he will never mention the series number of that node, and he may use it for some other transactions for some others.
So you are talking about the physical currency, right? Whatever money we use.
Correct, sir. But in that also, because it is half physical currency, half physical transaction, and the same amount, the note, whatever he receives, he may use it for some electronic transaction also.
See, that will become that he is going to spend, because see, double spending, if I give it to you and again I am trying to use the same money for other transaction, that comes as the double spending. Okay, if I give it to you and you are going to spend for some other reason, that will not become the double spending.
Okay.
Okay, so you are further making the transaction.
Fine, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Any other doubts?
So this IOTA is only for IoT, sir?
Actually, they say that if you are going for the IoT network, this will be the best choice. Okay, but it is not that we have to go only for IoT network, because see, in the real time, whatever is going on, so we are not sure whether only IoT devices are connected. Maybe any devices are connected.
Yeah. Okay. Sir, and in your presentation, you are just mentioning the IoT devices are having a limited capacity for computing.
Yes.
Therefore, data generated by the IoT devices cannot be, you know, for security reasons, for some reasons, it cannot be processed at the side of the devices itself. Then maybe the idea is to have the computation in an additional layer of blockchain networks, sir.
Additional layer. See, what happens in this particular IOTA network is you have to perform some operation. Okay. And yes, there are devices. We can divide into constrained device and non-constrained device, because any device can take part in the IoT network. Okay, yes. When it comes into a constrained devices, even in constrained devices itself, again, the configurations are heterogeneous. Let's say you have a sensor device.
Yes.
Okay, the sensor cannot do any other process for this IOTA activity other than just taking the sensing the temperature and forwarding it.
Yes.
Okay, in that case, the device cannot be part of the IOTA network, but it can take part as a client node, that is the light node. It will not store anything.
Yes.
What the operation it has to do is it has to create the transaction.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
And to identify the tip, it depends on some other node, because it cannot identify the tip. To identify the tip, it should have the tangle. Okay. So in that case, the light node will get the support of some other node. It may be permanent node or full node, which will work on behalf of the light node, that is the sensor device. And further, it will the transaction can be taken into the tangle.
Yes, sir. I got it, sir. But my one more question is, suppose IoT devices, as you said, if they are thin, not able to do the computation, if they rely on some other computing powers or devices, in that case, can we implement blockchain so that the customer data is stored safely with privacy, with smart contract terms and conditions, and enable the cloud computing quality of service to assure more guarantee of the services, sir?
See, the first thing in this IOTA, the computation required is very, very less when compared to Ethereum and Bitcoin.
Okay.
So because of that, the constrained devices can take part. And the second question what you put is, since it depends on other device.
Yes.
Okay. Definitely there is a privacy issue.
Yes.
Okay. Because see, here we use different transaction address for every transaction.
Yes.
Okay. And what happens if the light node goes to the full node and ask for a transaction, that transaction belongs to the particular light node. Okay, so please try to understand this. Light node made a transaction, and that is part of the main blockchain, and that is only available with the full node. So if the light node want to know what is the transaction and what the details.
Yes.
Full node and ask for the transaction. The light node asks for the particular transaction, definitely the full node will come to know that this transaction is relevant to this light node. So there is a privacy issue.
Yes, sir.
Okay, definitely it will be there. But yes, what the solutions given, one of the solutions, they have given multiple solutions. One of the solutions is that the light node should not ask exactly for one transaction. Let it ask for n number of transactions, and that n number will contain one transaction of the light node also. So then what happened? The full node cannot predict which transaction is belongs to the light node.
Yes, sir.
Okay, similarly, they have other solutions also. But in this solution, what happened? If the light node want to see its own transaction, it has to get n number of transaction and it has to process all. Okay, so that is the drawback with this solution. Okay, there are other solutions also available, but still that problem is not solvable in very simple manner. Okay, still the research is going on in it.
This is very interesting, sir, and your talk is giving a lot of opportunities for the implementation of several research works.
Okay.
So if you can kindly share your video of the lecture, it will be useful, sir.
I think this is with the organizers. I don't have any control on it.
Anyway, the session has been recorded, sir. It will be posted in the chat box.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So, any other questions?
So, you can continue to the next.
Okay, thank you. So, I hope the slide is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, now you can see the difference here with Bitcoin and Ethereum. So this is also cryptocurrency, and it is the decentralized application development. It is in process. When we have installed and simulated, we could not find the decentralized application. That is writing the smart contract, we could not find, but they are working on it. So this also works based on transactions similar to Bitcoin, that is UTXO. This also uses proof of work, but the target is very, very flexible. We cannot say it is flexible, that the target is very broad so that the puzzle can be solved very quickly. And here also the consensus algorithm is probabilistic, and the confirmation time, it depends on the milestone transaction or the majority of users. So if the more than 50% of users approved the transaction, that is the weight of the transaction is more than 50%, then the transaction is considered as confirmed. Or if the transaction is approved by the milestone transaction, then it will be considered as confirmed. And here also fork is there because of proof of work. And waiting time is 50%, because I said 50% of the user has to approve. And this is decentralization and no authority, but they are partially trying to bring some centralized authority for this. Then the network is permissionless, and there is no world state in the implementation. But when we are going for the snapshot is similar to the world state. So we can indirectly say that IOTA has the world state. So this is the comparison among Bitcoin, Ethereum, and IOTA. So what I wish to conclude in this is, if you are going to apply blockchain-based technology for any IoT applications, my suggestion is you can explore, and if your requirement is permissionless, that is the public network, you can explore IOTA. Okay, because here the proof of work is very, very less, so you can justify. And even for the storage, you can justify. We use Ethereum for the smart transportation, and in that, we claim that we will be taking the snapshot where we are taking the concept of IOTA and put in the Ethereum. So in that way we justify, because when we start to work on the particular application, we could not find IOTA concept. it came later. Even though we have simulated, we have not taken it for our application. And also we have implemented this Ethereum on the Raspberry Pi devices, and we found that it is sustainable because Raspberry Pi is not going to do the mining, but it becomes the light node and it gives the result in some reasonable time. Okay, I don't have the slides to share here now, but we have experimented it and it will be very soon get published. So you can think of IOTA for such kind of application. But if you are going for the permission network, it is always suggested to go for the Hyperledger based implementation. So just one second, let me try to share the CODA part. I will not take more than 2-3 minutes on the CODA. You can see the CODA here. This is the sample structure. It is not even the detailed structure. So is it visible?
No, 3D is quite better.
Okay. So this, you can see, this is the CODA. CODA has one advantage. If you are part of a subnetwork, no need to store the complete data of the blockchain. So you know, in Bitcoin or Ethereum, if you are the full node, you have to store all the transactions and all the blocks. But in case of CODA, that is not required. If Alice is part of this particular subnetwork, Alice has to store the transaction of only this subnetwork, not any other things. So similarly for Bob, Carl, and Demi, and Ed also. So in this way, what the CODA gives advantage to us is, no need, the storage space will be saved, and also you are not required to receive the transaction of other network. If Alice is there, Alice has to receive the transaction, whatever is belongs to this particular subnet. No need to receive the transaction of all others. So in that way, what happens, the communication and the storage and the quick confirmation of transaction, all these things are achieved. And CODA we can implement as permissioned as well as permissionless. So when it comes into permissioned, there will be a notary, and who is responsible for approving the transaction. When some X is making transaction to Y, the notary will verify the transaction and it says this, yes, the transaction is valid. So in this case, notary will have the complete transaction details of the subnetwork, and it does it. In case we want to make it as permissionless, we can include so many notaries, and the notaries will exchange the information, and they can make the prepare the consensus when we are going to get some transaction confirmed. So that is the advantage of CODA, and CODA is preferred in many of the banks these days. Even this CODA name itself from the consortium. Okay, there is a consortium where there are multiple players involved in that. Even banks are also there. They have involved and they have developed this. And even in some of the banks, the CODA is implemented. Because in CODA, what happens in the bank system, let's say this is IOB. Only the IOB users are going to see their transactions and the chain will be formed. When the IOB bank is going to have the connection with SBI bank, and you can see the intersection in this Venn diagram. So only those particular users, for example, the admins can have the interaction between the two subnetworks. So similarly here. So this gives more advantage to the applications to use the blockchain concept, as well as they can ensure that the storage space is less and the transactions are get confirmed quickly. So I don't have much time to discuss more in detail about CODA. So if you wish, you can contact me. Actually, we are writing a book. It's in the process. I can share you the draft that may give better idea. It's not only on CODA, it includes Bitcoin, Ethereum, Hyperledger, and the complete introduction about the blockchain. So if you have any questions, please let me know. Okay. So thank you so much for patient listening.
Sir, you have mentioned the explore IoT for implementing smart contract blockchain for constrained devices in case of permissioned network, sir.
Yes.
So okay, in case of permissionless or public networks, you are suggesting CODA to use, sir?
No. What I was suggesting is IOTA for the permissionless network.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay. Hyperledger when you go for permission network.
Permission network and it's still private network.
I have not explored CODA. The reason is we could not find any open source code. Because right now we are not in implementation. We concentrate more on our publication. So when we were trying to do the implementation, we could not get the code of CODA. So we got IOTA, we got Hyperledger, and we got Ethereum. Okay, on all these things, we have worked. So okay. I worked on Ethereum and my students worked on IOTA and Hyperledger. So we know much about these three things. In CODA level, our implementation part is very less. So I cannot give any suggestion about that. Okay, but I can give more detailed information from our book draft.
Fine, okay, sir.
If you need, I can share it with you later.
Sir, my one more question is, can we use IOTA and Hyperledger for implementation of smart contracts, blockchains in cloud computing, sir, to enhance the security aspects?
There is no point in using both. Okay, you can use any one, but as I said yesterday itself, before trying to apply the blockchain, please try to justify why blockchain is required for that particular application. Yes. And see, because when you go to the cloud, then that is centralized.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So why it is required and who are the participants?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Because if you take IOTA, there are full node, permanent node, developer node, and then light node. And if you go for Hyperledger, there are endorsers. And there are orderers and there are committers. Yes. So yes, we have to define all those participants in beforehand. Because when we make the architecture, if we know all these things very clear, then only the architecture will look good and you can justify.
Okay, sir. Then Hyperledger itself is enough, sir, to implement.
If you are going for permission network.
Permission network and yes, a private network.
Yes, yes.
And to store the data safely onto the cloud.
Data safely, actually what we do is, one application what we have done, we use blockchain for e-healthcare, okay, for the record management. So what we do is, we put the encrypted record on the cloud.
Yes.
Okay, and the metadata, that hash value of the cloud on the blockchain.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay, so the encrypted record is in the cloud and the metadata is in the blockchain. So when we have to verify the integrity of the message or the record, that can be verified using the metadata available in the blockchain.
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. So some hospital may access the record from the cloud and it can be decrypted with the help of patient. And then the integrity verified using the data available in the blockchain. So like that, we have done one implementation.
Yes, sir. But that will not take care of the privacy, no, sir?
We encrypt it, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And another thing, we keep the personal information and the blockchain identity not linkable. Okay. In that way, we ensure the privacy.
Okay, sir, but in case of IoT devices involved, as you said, the constraint devices, sensors. So in that case, Hyperledger may not be sufficient, no, sir?
Because, see, in Hyperledger, there is no computation required, right?
Yes, sir.
Only the communication required.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there is no problem.
Okay, okay. Fine, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Sir, there are some few questions from the participants in the chat box.
Yes, yes, I could see. The first one is, can we use any such Raspberry? Yes, we can use any of the devices. Actually, we used and we have only Raspberry Pi. That's why we used only Raspberry Pi and we have not used Arduino. We have to receive fund from government. Once it comes, we will buy. And for education system, yes, we can use considering the environment is the permissioned network, because in education system, mostly you know all of them in the beforehand. So in that case, you can go for Hyperledger.
Participants, any more questions?
Sir, hello. Hello.
Yes, yes, please.
Sir, you said the when we add more number of nodes in Tangles, our performance, I mean, in terms of transaction, it increases. Why, sir? I mean, because of its, I mean, directed acyclic nature, I mean, graph nature, or
what happens is when the number of transactions are more, the cumulative weight or the score of the particular transaction will increase. So when it increases, then automatically you see that 50% I was talking about, that will be ensured quickly.
Okay. But in other blockchain, I mean, in terms of Hyperledger or Ethereum, when the more number of nodes increases, the performance, I mean, in terms of transaction, it decreases. Is it, sir?
We can say like that because the majority has to accept. Okay, and the transaction has to be broadcasted to all the nodes. So because of that, there will be a delay.
Okay.
And the scalability issue is definitely there when we are going for proof of work based.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Sorry. In Byzantine base, we have the scalability issue. But in case of proof of work, scalability issue is not there, but the confirmation delay issue is there. So somebody has asked, in Hyperledger, we have to write own coding. See, actually, in Hyperledger, we have to write the smart contract according to our requirement. So the Hyperledger is the framework. No need to make any change in the framework level. Okay, so you have to write the smart contract. But if you are going for Ethereum, there you can make the change as per your requirement also if you don't want to use the smart contract. In Hyperledger, you have to write the code. Any other questions, please?
So shall we conclude the session?
Yes, yes.
Yes. So I, on behalf of the manager,
sir.
Yes, madam.
Yes, yes, continue, sir.
Sir, Venkateshan, sir, is there any what you call hardware integration work where we can refer and work on applying blockchain, as you said, IoT for hardware IoT devices?
Yes, you can go for it. I remember once my friend was planning to make such kind of things. Okay, but it's not IoT. They want to bring out the blockchain implementation on the hardware because we know that, in hardware, it will be, the processing will be faster.
Hardware encryption,
So he was trying to do, but in between he left. Okay, and definitely you can find some work. If it is not there and if you have sufficient infrastructure with you, please start work on it so that you will be the first one for that.
Okay, sir.
But I'm not sure, I have not explored much on internet regarding this, but my friend was planning to work on it.
Yes, sir.
So there's another question in the chat box.
Yes, yes. Smart contract and Hyperledger, we have to combine for. See, actually, Hyperledger is the platform. Okay, so to run your application on the platform, you have to write the smart contract code. That is the chain code you have to write.
Okay, sir. We shall conclude the session, sir.
Okay.
So I, on behalf of the management, director, principal, HOD, CSE, and my dear colleagues of KCG College of Technology, and the entire team and the co-owner of this FDP, we thank the speaker, Dr. S. Venkatesan, for sharing his knowledge, work, findings, and opinions, especially the details on Ethereum, Bitcoin, and IoTA was excellent, sir. And I also thank the participants of session 10 for extending the cooperation, smooth conduction of the program. Participants, you can join us back at 11:45 for the next session. Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for coming here, sir.